She keeps them away,
our next guest. She's good. From my hometown, West Hartford, we've got a really special person who's been fighting, kind of like I did years ago in West Hartford. You can win there. You got to really wind it up and fight for what you believe in West Hartford, Connecticut. Town Councilor Mary Fay. Morning, Mary.
Good morning. How are you, Joe?
Good. How's it going?
It's going great. I'm doing fine.
I see you were in Florida. I think I caught on, was it Florida I caught on Facebook?
I was. I took my dad down to his place down there, and it was great. We had a great time together, and, you know, it's been a little rough on him. My mom passed away in July.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
And, yeah, and we're a very close family, and she was truly the matriarch, but he's doing great. I just talked to him last night, and he's doing fine.
Yeah, I got to get down there hopefully in a couple of weeks. Oh, I keep saying it, but I don't go. Get bogged down with business. So tell the public, you know, you're from West Hartford and everyone thinks, oh, it's just Democrats over there. And how the whole world it's been. I've been out of the town politics for a while and all the work that you do that affects our town and exactly and also how beautiful the town is. Contrary to the Democratic Party running it, we love the town. And what are your thoughts on our town and also state issues that are affecting the Greater Hartford area?
Certainly. Thanks, Joe, for the introduction. So I'm very pleased to be on this program this morning. So thank you for the invitation. I've been a council person, councilwoman, council, whatever you want to call it, but council person for, this is my second term. And I think anybody, and I believe this across the board, regardless of party affiliation, anybody who runs for public office, for the most part, is really doing it because they love where they live. They want to make a difference. They want to represent all citizens. They want to make their town or their state a better place. I really do believe that. Now, there are exceptions. There are some people in there, I believe, who just want to do it because it's, you know, you can get some power, you can get some visibility, you can get some cronyism because of Democrats have run our state for so long. You can get commission appointments, you can get things like that. But that's certainly not why I'm in this. In fact, if that was the reason, I would have kept my Democrat affiliation and I'd probably be very high up in government right now. But I'm doing this because of Republican principles. I believe we've got to get back to some basics here in town and in the state, and we've got to get us back on track. You mentioned Florida, and I had to say I did spend about a week and a half, 2 weeks down there. And it's booming. It's absolutely booming. Yeah. And I think it's because of their policies, their financial and economic policies, and some of their social policies. I was in Lake County, Florida, which is the fastest growing county in all of Florida. You know, a lot of people are moving up from southern Florida because, quite frankly, it's a mess down there. And the southern part of the state is largely controlled by Democrats. And again, I don't want to.
Yeah, I know. I spent five years in Coconut Grove with my family doing television production in the 90s. And it was on the edge after the hurricane. It came back, South Beach and all that. But it did start to get a little crazy, which is why we moved home, brought the family back to Connecticut. It was a little nuts down in South Florida.
It is. But if you go to Central, Lake County is north and west of Orlando. So you fly into Orlando Airport, which is magnificent. It's very easy to navigate yourself around there. It's very clean. It's pristine. Great shuttles. It's quick through the security guards. And you can get to Ocala or wherever you're going pretty quickly. In fact, I'm sure a lot of your listeners have heard about the development called the Villages. Now, that's not where we are. We're in the vicinity, but not in that particular development. It's got 160,000 residents, and they're building. There's cranes and new development going up every day. It's really a city now. So a lot of people are flocking there, and I think it's because of their policies.
It is the policies. It's, when I got back from Miami back in 99, I said, I missed the north. I missed the, and I'll never forget saying, I just got to see the snow and Thanksgiving and Christmas and this change of seasons. I love it. And so I think a lot of people feel that way. Some people have come back, and we always go to Florida for vacationing. But the Connecticut, really, how can we, in our town, as you know, our taxes on our property, I've got a ranch house, 2,000-foot ranch house, and we're at $10,000 a year.
Yeah.
And so at what point does that now then become 11, 12? I mean, maybe 5, 6, 7 years, it'll be 14,000 a year. This is New York City tax base going on here in our town of West Hartford. I don't think it can stop, but what happens?
Well, I think, and certainly the minority party, there's three of us, and the council is controlled by 6 Democrats largely. But yeah, I want to be fair. I consider everybody on the council a close associate.
I understand.
Yeah, and so I don't want to be disparaging towards anybody, but they do have control, and they do set a lot of the economic policy. But there are a lot of things we do come united on, and for example, we all voted unanimously to approve a development plan for Corbin's Corner, which I think is going to make that section of town, you know, really beautiful and encourage the business people to come, and it's going to be good for customers and residents. So our focus collectively is to grow the grand list. We've got to get more development in town and proper development. I mean, really, you know,
yeah,
proper.
But Mary, I saw that with Blueback as I fought years ago, and that was the case.
Yeah.
But I believe that the education budget is the one that just explodes. And we do such a great job with education and children with disabilities, and we're never properly recompensed by the state. And so for me, the chase development is great on private property, but at some point we are going to almost run out of property. When do we curve back, or how do we tackle what I've called, it's what I do, it's called the education cartel. At what point do we actually get the money and the power to the teachers to support them, but cut the administration, or at least everything everyone knows, the reporting, the Common Core, state, federal mandates to just pile on and make this into a swamp. And the teachers are burdened with so much. And I think the town side as a counselor for a couple of years, I watched, we do a great job there. But education, even though we do a great job, it's costing us. And how do we get our money back? How do we get our money from the state equally? I don't think we get what we deserve.
Yeah, so there's a couple things. I talked about the revenue side, but I don't think that's the answer, quite honestly, because we're in a similar situation, though not as dire as the state. And the state just always wants more revenue, which means higher taxes.
Yeah.
That's not a proper solution. We're at a tipping point where at the 42 and change mill, people are walking to other areas. Farmington is a big beneficiary of folks leaving West Hartford, as is Bloomfield. So there are other alternatives, and certainly if you consider east of the river, you've got South Windsor and Glastonbury, which are much lower. So we're at a tipping point, and I believe that
we've
got to do more on the expense side. So one thing that we asked for, the minority party asked for last budget cycle, was a flat budget. We've got to figure out ways to be more efficient, reduce headcount. I know that's not popular. A lot of these things aren't going to be popular. And we've got to work on the benefits and fringes and do things more efficiently.
Right.
Shop insurance, get better quotes, do a lot of things differently, consolidate departments even. And we're going to have to start making some difficult decisions. You mentioned education, and that is the lion's share. We've really got to streamline that as well. And that doesn't mean overburdening teachers. I think the big draw to West Hartford's education system is the fact that we have smaller class sizes.
Mm-hmm.
And we certainly don't want to disrupt that. But there is declining enrollment. And
that's coming in
for several years, and it's projected to decline into the future. So I think we're doing well on a pure pupil cost-wise. We're in the middle of the pack in terms of ranking all the towns, 169 towns in Connecticut. But we've got to do more, because I think citizens are getting very concerned about the cost and taxes. Seniors in particular, when I go door knocking, I've run, as you know, 3 campaigns for 3 years. That's their number one concern, and we can't be tone deaf to that. So we've got to find creative solutions. I envision at some point, perhaps, I know this is very controversial and I'm going to get a lot of letters and hate mail for this, but we're gonna have to consolidate some schools and do some things differently. We just can't afford the tax.
Well, yeah, which is why I've termed it years ago the education cartel. It's not against teachers when I say that term, but
no.
it's a process where the more, and this is all state governments everywhere. This is how it runs. The more employees there are, this is again not the employees against them, but the more employees, the more bodies, the more overtime, the more cost, the more I call it the government union skim. And there are forces in there that don't want to. They buck this consolidation, doing things streamlined like private sector. And so the bureaucracy from state, federal, and also the local piles on in the effort to, I hate to use the word skim, but it's government union dues is what I mean. And so this huge amount of money coming in, it doesn't want to allow the system to make itself leaner and meaner, and also support the teachers. When I was running for governor in 2014, I addressed a lot of teachers at the Toyota building, and just basically said the teachers need to not have all the testing and everything dumped on them. It doesn't mean we have to hire tons of administrators. We've got to cut back these unfunded mandates or fund them.
Right.
And we're not. And I think the key is that a lot of parents. Well, I had three kids go through the system. But don't really want to buck it. Old timers. Now I'm an old timer. I'm going to yell. I don't got any kids in the school system. I don't want to pay all these taxes and all that nonsense. But the forces that want to stop the process of real time adjustment, like private sector does, and government doesn't. We're at that point, I think, not just West Hartford, but Connecticut, where it doesn't mean fire teachers or harm your kids, and that's the kind of boogeyman they use all the time. But some force has to do it, and it always ends up to taxpayers groups and the old timers that fight it. And now I think they don't even fight anymore, they just leave. They just decide, no more referendums, let's just get out of here.
Yeah, well, that's, I think that we're at the tipping point where people are just going to throw up their hands. And, you know, the old saying, which I hate, is you can't fight City Hall. And they're getting at that point. They're so frustrated. So getting back to education, because I think this is important, because I think there's a sense that Republicans are anti-education. Look, I come from a very long line of teachers. I come from the Faye side is law enforcement. Lots of police officers, FBI officers, things like that on the Bay side. On the Wayland side, my mom's side, you know, a very long line of educators. My mom is a retired school teacher. She taught me East Hartford, my hometown. My sister, Kathleen, is a teacher, and my grandparents were teachers. In fact, my grandfather went on to become superintendent. You couldn't find a better advocate of teachers than me. I've lived with them. I've lived with my mother and, you know, knew how hard she worked and how much she advocated for her children. You know, she used to raid our closets to bring in clothes for these kids and take our games and our books and bring them in and give them away. So I know how hard teachers work and I know how important they are. So I would certainly never do something that would harm a teacher,
right,
a classroom size, or our children's learning experience. It's the overhead, though, quite frankly.
Yep.
And we do need to address that. And I think there's a lot of education we need to do. In fact, when the state came forward and as a solution for pensions, I want to make sure teachers get their pensions. I don't want to cut them and take them away. They've earned them. When they said that teachers were going to contribute an extra 1%, you know, the union and the CEA went and said that we're trying to tax them extra. No, we're not taxing them.
That's what I mean about the education cartel. That's who I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah,
their 1% is going into their pension to shore it up so they make sure they get paid.
Yeah.
So it's their money and they're going to get it back when they get their pension. So the extra 1%, in fact, their contribution still is not at the level of what the national average is. I think the national average is at 10%, and I think our teachers in Connecticut contribute 8%. So we got to stop this fighting and just solve the problem. And maybe the teachers should put in 10%, but they're going to get it back.
Right.
That's my point.
Right. Well, it's hard to change the government union workforce at all levels because there's such internal power structure within. This is going on, but it's at a point where people move in from New York because it's still affordable. And that's what you're seeing in West Hartford. You're seeing people come in. And for the listeners out there, so you understand, our town was Republican until about the year 2000. And it a lot of small business owners live in West Hartford, and they work their butt off. And they work really hard. They're not all wealthy people in West Hartford. A lot of the state capital, the people that run our state, live in our town. And the majority of the media lives in West Hartford. So we're at this crazy intersection of working class people, business owners. It was really a cross section of America in West Hartford, but the fact is that it's telling you that our town is telling the state. We're done, and when we get done, we can't afford it anymore, then the rest of the state's going to really follow, because when people of means can't take it and have to leave, this is where we are. So, of course, I'm blaming the Democrats because they have the power. If it was the Republicans, I'd be beating them over the head, too. But, well, that's the way the game is. And the reality is that the Dems are more beholden to government unions and the permanent welfare class for votes and power rather than sensible adjustment like private sector does. And if there's a time in history in America that you have to adjust to changing times and economics and demographics, it's now. And so, without harming people and firing them, how would, Mary, would we in our town, where would you attack, or I hate to say attack, where would you approach hard the first maybe one, two, and three, if you have them in your mind, to make the changes we think you need?
Yeah, so I think it's only fair that I disclose a little bit more of my background. So I'm an accountant by education and starting my career off, and went back for MBA and in finance, and was able to develop my career into a senior executive when I was in my 30s working for GE Capital. So the notion that you need to keep throwing money at problems is absolutely incorrect. And I know government's not a business. I really do. But I believe that a lot of business principles can be applied to government. So let me give you an example. So I was running a large operation for GE, and our costs were really, really high, and we couldn't compete with the, we have to compete in business. So there's a lot of other providers of similar services. And if you can't compete, you're done. So I was able to streamline the operation by doing things, redesigning process was number one, technology was number two, getting the right people in place, not just letting people sit there who weren't contributing and doing their job, really, you know, making difficult decisions and swapping them out and getting higher caliber people, giving them a career path. And before you knew it, we reduced costs significantly. But here's the interesting part. Here's the but. Everybody thinks if you reduce costs, you're going to kill service and you're going to kill your result and it's going to be terrible. We reduced costs, but we measured everything with Six Sigma. Our service to customers went up. We were performing better at a reduced cost. And it wasn't offshoring. We didn't offshore anything. It was all done in the United States.
Wow.
So you can do these type of things. It's absolutely
possible. But in government, the rules, the process, the procedures are mostly government union-led and hard to change and hard to maximize the efficiencies. I think that's probably what it is. People are, I know that from DOT and other friends working in the state government, are like, we can't, there's dead weight everywhere. The process just doesn't let us move over here. We're killing time over there. That could be done, but the rule says we can't do this without that, without this, without that. And so there's a huge bureaucratic nightmare led by special interest is causing inefficiencies and non-productive services. You're right.
Well, one thing I learned very quickly, as you know, I ran for state rep in the 18th district last year, and or 2 years ago, I should say. And what I've learned very quickly is that government and politicians, candidacies, is not a meritocracy. So that's a very different view than I previously had. In business, you know, if you don't cut it, you don't make it, you're gone.
Not in government.
Not in government. And you have to have your goals, and you have to hit them. So to me, the incentives are misaligned with what really needs to be done, number one. Number two, I think they're tone deaf to what people want. So here's a perfect example. People are screaming against the ammo tax, and I don't know what's going to happen. I would hope that if people weren't tone deaf, that would see it would be dead on arrival, DOA. And similarly with the tolls, West Hartford was a leader. I actually took on championing because I listen to people and I listen to all constituents. I don't care if they're blue or red. It doesn't matter to me. But the overwhelming cry was no tolls in Connecticut.
Can't take anymore.
And at the time, you know, I was measuring and researching. It was about 80% of residents across the state did not want tolls. So West Hartford could have been a leader. We took I wrote in with my two compadres in the minority party. We put forward a resolution to support no tolls in Connecticut. Well, I never saw the light of day.
I remember reading about that. They killed it, Mary. We only have a few minutes left, and I want to hit one of the topics.
My point is, we have to stop the finger pointing and polarizing. And we could have all won. We could have all won on that. Democrats too, because look at tolls right now are off the table. Yep. For the time being, I don't trust that they're gone.
They'll be back.
And we could have been on the right side of that. Yeah. That's my point.
Let's hit the last issue. It's a social issue, and it's important, I think. And I want you to be on that committee. And why don't you tell the public about what's happening? And I really think you should represent and be representative on an issue that kind of we read about on Facebook.
Oh, yeah. It's important to me and my family. So I think West Hartford on the social issues is a leader. And we are a very inclusive community, and we do our part in terms of championing, people's rights. I do think we could be a little overboard with the resistance movement. Sanctuary cities. I mean, that even came up to make West Hartford a sanctuary town. I'm not so sure that swimming against the tide of the law is the right place to be. But having said that, there will be a gay pride festival sponsored here in West Hartford in June. And the host committee was named, and I saw it, and I said, gee, my name's not on there. That's rather odd. And it turned into what I perceived, again, my perception, that it turned into a hugely politicized day instead of really a gay pride day. So all the 14 host committee members were all Democrats, including, you know, state senators and state officials and all of the Democrat town councilors. And I said, where's my name? How come I'm not on there? I was included in the second round of invitations, which came out much later. So of course I was upset being, you know, I was highly profiled last year in my state race as being one of the few gay Republicans running. And, you know, it's important to me and my family to be represented. We're all human beings, and I certainly champion this.
So how does it sit now? Are you on the committee or?
I did get the invitation, and I'm trying to talk to some of the leaders to just kind of get on the same page. But yes, I do fully intend to support it.
No, I know you would support it. The question was whether you were blocked and for political reasons.
That was my perception. Yeah. That was what I really believed. Because I would have thought that one of the persons, even on the committee, whether it was Beth Kerrigan, a fellow counselor, or Beth Bye, somebody that I know and respect, would have reached out to me and said, hey, how come Mary's not on here?
Right.
But nobody did. And so when I saw it in print, I was deeply offended, and it did seem to be politicized. But in the second round of invites, or third round, I don't even know what number. But
I think a little Facebook posting and commenting by a few people got people worried over there. That's how that town runs. I know all too well. And yeah, they did. They probably finally did the right thing. And, you know, I know most of them personally, and everybody, you know, we fight like cats and dogs when I was on council, but that's just the way that is. Love our town. Mary, we're running out of time. We will definitely have you on again at some point, but God bless you for being here, and keep fighting for the people of Connecticut and the residents of West Hartford.
Hey, Joe, and thank you so much for what you're doing. Thanks for your engagement, and I'd love to come back again.
Sure. Thanks so much.
Okay.
Okay, Mary Fay. Wow. We'll be right back, folks.